Για να καταλαβαίνει και η καλεσμένη μας, η εκλεκτή, θα την παρουσιάσω πάρα πολύ σύντομα στα αγγλικά. Εντάξει.
So we're so happy to have Maria Giulia Dondero with us today. We met her in Lund, Sweden, a few months ago. We immediately invited her here because her work is extremely pertinent to what we do right here. We felt she was the best person to speak about the semiotics of the image, since she has studied the religious image, the scientific image, the artistic image as well. She was formed in art history. And she's written a couple of books that would be, it would be really nice to have them in English, actually.
The only one we do have
in English today with us is The Semiotic Challenge of Scientific Images. But she's also written a couple of books on the semiotics of photography. Another one on the semiotics of the religious image that are only available in French. Is there a translation being planned somewhere in the world that we should know of?
I think that it will be difficult to translate for the Anglophonian world, the specificities of post-Grimassian semiotics in French. But I always hope that someone will be interested in translate.
Yeah, let's hope one of our students at some point takes up the task.
Me. Wonderful.
Or we can do it in Greek. She is currently a researcher at the National, it's something like the National Research Institute of Belgium. It's called the Fonds National de Recherche Scientifique in Belgium. And she also teaches visual semiotics at the University of Liège. Originally from Italy, she studied in Bologna and Milan, you know, two grand centers of semiotic studies. And I think you will be very interested in hearing what she has to tell us today.
Thank you so much, Leah. I'm very happy to be here at the Semiotic Lab, and I'm pleased to thank very much Leah Iocca and Evangelios Kurdis for this invitation. Before beginning my talk, I'd like to say a word about two research projects in which I'm involved and that can explain the orientation of my talk today. After a long period when my main research topics focused on semiotics of religious image and of artworks, as Leah said, and after a period of time devoted to scientific images and diagrammatic thinking, I decided to try to understand how the automatic and computational analysis could help me in my transcorpora research project, the grammar, the project of a life, of a whole life, the grammar of images and metavisual devices. The first one is a four-year project that I'm directing at the University of Liège. The title of the project is Big Visual Data, a semiotic approach to indexing and visualizing image archives. It will run from 218 to 221, and it is financed by the National Belgian Fund for Scientific Research. This project has been inspired by the media visualization proposed by Lev Manovich in the last decade, and it deals with metavisual devices of visualization and analysis of images. I will show you later. I'll come back later on Lev Manovich's work. The second one, the second project I'm involved in, have been submitted to the French financing institution ANR, Agence Nationale de la Recherche in France, by Pierluigi Basso from the University of Lyon. I'm a partner in this submission. This international ANR project will deal with the genealogy of forms and with the automatic analysis of images. Its title is Augmented Artwork Analysis, Computer-Aided Interpretation Device for Art Images. My talk will examine today the research project of a genealogy of forms as it was conceived of in the work of Abi Warburg, in particular in the Atlas Mnemosyne, 1924-1929, and in the book The Life of Forms in Art, Vie de Forme, by Henri Faucillon, 1934. These projects, the project of Warburg and the project of Faucillon, were left unfinished because of the difficulty of analyzing patterns in big heterogeneous corpora. Currently, in the age of image datasets, image processing, and deep learning, the heterogeneity of corpora is no longer an obstacle. Computer visualization approaches using convolutional neural networks have demonstrated their efficacy in pattern recognition in very large dataset of images. And the extraction of plastic figures to build the signature of an image, called feature vector signature, can now be used to detect patterns in heterogeneous corpora. My presentation today consists of two parts. In part one, I will review the research projects of Warburg and Faucillon from the standpoint of a genealogy of forms. In the second part, I will focus on current research projects in the USA and in Europe that are continuing this ambitious and demanding research project, notably the meta-visualization of culture analytics lab led by Lev Manovich. I will also take into consideration the replica project by the Digital Humanities Lab of École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne in Switzerland and the Technical Art History Project by Marco Cardinali at the Biblioteca Herziana in Rome. Before dealing with the projects of Faucillon and Warburg, before dealing with the first part of my talk, I'd like to address some reflections about media visualization and Gray-Massian semiotics. The media visualization project analyzes large collection of images, the big data, the visual big data, through visualization that illuminate and compare, as you can see here, several painters' trajectories from a diachronic point of view. See here the example of Rochko here and Mondrian here. Media visualization also analyzes the temporal trajectory of a painter's production, as you can observe here in the case of Rochko's career. This screenshot is from a video of Jeremy Douglas, who worked with Manovich at the CALIT II at the University of California, San Diego, who shows the two main organization strategies of the same dataset, the whole career of Rochko paintings. The montage, this is the montage organization of the images. So the montage is on the right side. The paintings are placed according to a chronological order from the first that had been produced to the last one. And here you can see a multitude of analytical diagrams on the left side. The diagrams that you can see here better, the diagrams do position images not in a chronological order, but they organize them in an analytical order, not chronological, but analytical order that depends on the plastic features, on the plastic similarities between images. So, the images that are most similar are close one another in the same region, and the images that are more distant are in the opposite side, are positioned in the opposite side. But we'll have time to come back to this visualization. In order to study this kind of diagrams, I adapted the notion of semi-symbolism to the big corpora in a paper recently published in the Canadian journal Semiotica. Here you can see the title. I can send this paper to you if you are interested. Traditionally, in Gray-Massian semiotics, the semi-symbolic relationship refers to a relation between a categorical opposition on the expression plane of an utterance, of a text, of an image. We are on the plane of perceptibility. So what is important in the case of images is are the categories, the topological, eidetical, chromatic categories that compose the plastic domain. And this categorical opposition on the expression plane corresponds to a categorical opposition on the content plane, on the plane of semantics. Semi-symbolism in the context of big data would be more along the lines of studying a group of images and not a single visual utterance. This group of images that share, for instance, the same brightness and the same color saturation on the plane of expression, along with another group that has the opposite features. So we oppose a region of images that has the same brightness and the same color saturation, for instance, to another group that has the opposite features, the opposite characteristics. Relating this opposition to the plane of the content, we would be examining oppositions based not on general categories, such as life, death, or nature, culture, as in Gray-Massian semiotics and in Levi-Strauss anthropology, but on characteristics specific to the world of images. For instance, the genre, the type of perspective and visual enunciation, and so on. In this sense, this kind of visual analysis, this visual visualization that is an analysis as well, visualizations are metavisual. In what sense? That is to say that visual and topological instruments are capable of analyzing visual discourse. As Paolo Fabbri stated in his Semiotic Turn in 1998, that is to say the autonomy of non-verbal languages. Non-verbal languages are able to reflect on themselves without going through verbal explanations. As far as media visualization of Lev Manovich is concerned, there are at last four metavisual levels. We speak about metavisuality in four different sense. So these visualizations are images of images. It's not difficult to agree. The parameters used to arrange the images are not metadata, but visual parameter to extract plastic features from the corpora. Third reason, the automatic distribution of the image is visualized spatially in a calculated topological presentation governed by abscissas and ordinates. Fourth reason, the content analysis enabled by media visualization allows a description of images from a perspective that respects the peculiarity and specificity of the realm of images, filiation, tradition, citation, genre, and so on, and does not make necessary to rely on the abstract realm of verbal description to study images. Media visualization maximizes the fact that the similarities and dissimilarities, differences of images, are inherent to the plan of expression of images, and the analysis of content does not depend on lexicalization or on standard metadata such as production date, author, and so on. Everyone will be able to recognize in this automatic visualization the heritage of Abi Warburg panels of images that are the first attempts to visualize images according to the similarities of their forms and according to the movement that is inherent to every form. It was the first attempt to understanding the influence of images on images, even unconscious and undirected influences, through a visual media, the panel, a surface that allows to see close and distant images in a gradual relation. Let's begin with Fossillon and Warburg's intellectual projects. In the first part of my talk, I will outline the reasons why it is necessary to go back to fundamental knowledge developed in art history, particularly to works on the genealogy of forms, in order to try to develop automatic analysis of a vast image collections. The return to the work of Warburg and Fossillon on forms is necessary for at least two reasons. First, to respond to the largely justified criticism that several researchers in media studies, think to Johanna Drucker and Gary Hall, for instance, and in art history, think to Claire Bishop, have raised about the current state of research in digital art history and digital humanities. These critics concern the precedence of methodology over theory, as well as the precedence of mechanical positivism over critical thinking. Secondly, it is necessary to return to these fundamental texts because they make it possible to problematize the work devoted to visual similarities in machine learning and to make it more complex. I will begin by touching on Fossillon's and Warburg's work on the genealogy of forms. The two works are brought together by a biological conception of forms, as well as by their vision of the succession of forms over time. The first important notion that Fossillon have examined is the interval between the manifestation of one form and the manifestation of another form that takes it up and transforms it. So, about the interval, Fossillon states that, I'm quoting, "It's not enough to know that the facts follow one another. They follow one another at certain intervals. And these very intervals do not only allow for an implementation, but already we could say an interpretation. The relationship between two facts over time is not the same depending on whether they are more or less distant from each other. There is something analogous to the relationship of objects in space and under light to their relative dimension to the projection of their shadows." What Fossillon in The Life of Forms in Art generically calls metamorphosis through intervals, through period of times, Warburg more technically calls a process of depolarization and repolarization. For Warburg, who aims to construct an iconology of the interval is charged with energy ready to be unloaded and polarized differently. I can't review all the similarities between Warburg's and Fossion's thinking within the scope of this presentation. I just like to briefly recall a few of them. The interval, sure, including the conception of conflict and stratification of forms from different times within the same period of history. This is to say that one image can incorporate motifs of different period of time. Renaissance motif with more contemporary motifs, and so on. Abi Warburg identifies active conflict in the Renaissance style, where the mathematical, the Apollinean, and the Dionysian minds coexist. Think of the famous figure of the Nymph, for example. Fossion is very close to this idea, particularly when he states that history is to be understood as an overlapping of widely extended presents. This means that for Fossion, two heterogeneous formal and semantic characteristics can coexist in the same style at the same time in history. This means as well that both Fossion and Warburg consider that the part of an image may not be synchronous. In addition, the two researchers work on the latent effects of forms. On this subject, one of the most suggestive sentences of the life of forms in art describes the emergence of one form from another, using the notion of an aura that Benjamin used as well, as you know. For form is surrounded, it's always a quotation from Fossion, for form is surrounded by a certain aura. We'll find again the idea of aura at the end of my presentation. Although it is our most strict definition of space, it also suggests to us the existence of other forms. It prolongs and diffuses itself throughout our dreams and fancies. We regard it, as it were, a kind of fissure through which crowds of images aspiring to birth may be introduced into some indefinite realm, a realm which is neither that of physical extent nor that of pure thought. The tension between every work of art, the uniqueness, the evidence, the realization of a totality performed by every work of art, and its purpose to generate other images via the aura it creates all around, makes fully apparent the question of the sketch precisely, which in my opinion has been somewhat neglected in current digital art history. So, the sketch draws attention to the fact that each work of art must be studied through the formal movements that prepared it. That is why the final versions of every image are only one of the possible perspectives for investigation. It would be necessary to take into account the oscillations that occurred in the sketches that prepared them, that prepared every work of art. Contemporary modeling in technical art history led by Marco Cardinali in Italy and in Sweden is on the contrary committed, in the contrary in relation to the machine learning, the contemporary machine learning, is on the contrary committed to the study of gradual changes between one sketch and the other by reconstructing through a dynamic diagram, hesitations, pentimento stratigraphy, and the progressive realization of uncertain forms. As you can see here, you can see different sketches of a Caravaggio painting, The Calling of St. Matthew. In this slide, we see three images extracted from Marco Cardinali's paper entitled Digital Tools and Technical Views, The Intersection of Digital Art History and Technical Art History in a Digital Archive on the Painting Technique of Caravaggio and His Followers. This paper was published in February 2019 in the journal Visual Resources. Thanks to the X-ray image in Caravaggio's Calling of St. Matthews, a series of pentimento becomes apparent. You know the final artwork. The purpose of modeling these types of trajectory of forms, what we call the uncertain forms, is to present the forms to computer vision and pattern recognition technicians as a variable tension between contrasting, between opposing forms, and not forms as something stable and steady. In relation to opposing and contrasting forms inside a unique painting, for instance, this painting or this one or this one, you can see, for instance, in Bacon's painting that some forces are at work, as Deleuze stated in his seminal book, The Logic of Sensation. Bacon's paintings are built on restraining and diffusion forces, so the constructing forces of restrain and diffuse energies, on figures that extend beyond their frame and which, through acrobatics, are absorbed by devices such as the sink here, and toilets, or umbrellas. As you can see here, the face is diffusing inspired into the umbrella blackness. So, some other paintings stage forces allowing the body to explode, like here, for instance, and the figures are always caught in a conflict between restraining forces, signified by geometric figures, and explosion. Here as well we have the restraining, contracting geometric figures, and explosion and dissipation forces. Like here, dissipation, for instance. Let us consider Abbie Warburg's idea about tension of forms in particular. He devotes his attention to tensions of forms in different painting, forces between paintings, so forces inside the painting, Warburg, but as well forces between paintings. And so not only inside one painting. Although known as an anti-formalist, Warburg is one of the art historians who most assertively rejects a trivial distinction between form and content. Like Faucillon, he's devoted his work to the biological relationship between life and forms. In this sense, the works of Faucillon and Warburg are very close, and very close to the fundamental idea of the tensive model in French semiotics, the Silberberg model. The oppositions are always gradual, and to measure and to study the entire spectrum of a category, we need the two concepts: intensity, the qualitative characteristics of a discourse, and extension, quantitative characteristics of a discourse. In a paper entitled Abby Warburg and the Nameless Science, a very, very famous article, Giorgio Agamben examines his conception of the transmission and the survival of forms. Agamben describes memory as the ability to react to an event. We come back to the interval. To react to an event over a variable period of time, the above-mentioned interval. The trace left by the event is a potential energy that is stored and then possibly reactivated and discharged. In these images and in the images and symbols too, this energy is preserved, which is then selected according to the wishes of the different successive periods. We can witness the revival of a motif, for example, a motif from Renaissance paganism, as we saw in the first image of the panel by Warburg. In other words, images and symbols in images are considered dynamograms that are forms that have recorded a dynamic force. The aesthetics of the dynamograms that Warburg aims to establish can be described in three phases of a process that explains the survival of the patterns: polarization, depolarization, and repolarization. It is the contact with the new era that allows polarization, which can change or even totally reverse the original meaning of the symbol. This polarization in which pictorial art develops shows that the categories of work of art and authorship lose their consistency in Warburg's thinking. The artist is never an inventor of forms, but rather someone who participates in the metamorphosis of motifs. Let's dwell a little longer on Faucillon's idea of form, because it allows us to focus on fundamental characteristics of the image that are not taken into consideration enough or even at all by computational analysis. The technique of the production process and the relationship between figure and background. According to Faucillon, the background is a dangerous concept because it prevents us to study the development of figures and the complexity of forms. Faucillon argues that form cannot be identified with its mere contour. This means that studying the schematization of the image, the contour, the structure of the Albertian perspective, or the geometry in the image, cannot be sufficient in an analysis of the form, since the form is always supported by matter, which precisely shapes form, and by technique, matter material. One of the weaknesses that we can detect in the practices of a current automatic image analysis is precisely the lack of attention to the resonance of forms with the media, with the material that support them. I will try to explain this more in depth. At present, analysis of the visual similarities of images obtained by computational instruments are carried out mainly in two ways: by using only feature extraction, the extraction of the plastic qualities of images such as those called plastic categories in Grimassian semiotics, that are shape contours, chromatic and topological differences, and so on. This is the strategy adopted, for example, by Google Art Project, which produces images, which produces analysis of all the images from the world leading museums that it has scanned itself. The main shortcoming of feature extraction used alone is that the similarities between the shapes that are identified by the algorithms are neither historically nor technically relevant. It's only form, nothing else. The second way, the second type of automatic analysis is through the combination of a first classification by standard metadata, that is production date, author, genre, place of production, and so on, and a later form of classification by grouping images, as we saw in Lev Manovich's visualizations, according to their plastic characteristics. This is the dual path opened by Lev Manovich and cultural analytics, which appears to be the most complete one: metadata and visual extraction. But every way has its default. The main flow of classification by standard metadata is that images are classified according to information added to the image via lexicalization, which do not correspond to the characteristics that identify each image as unique. Nor do the lexicalization used in the classification of images reflect the characteristics of visual language, namely the forms of organization peculiar to image. All things considered, this procedure has the same shortcoming as Roland Barthes' semiology, which used the segmentations offered by verbal language to read the image, to analyze the image, and which has been usefully criticized by Grimassian semiotics. The procedure that operates a first filter and a first classification via standard metadata may prefigure certain results or overly restrict the corpus to be analyzed later by the feature extraction process. The risk is that metadata classification is already influenced too much by stabilized knowledge in art history. This prevents discoveries and consequently a renewal of the categories used in art history or a critical look at them. In both cases, attention to the media characteristics of the image or even its technique is very low in image processing. Yet the technique is what matters most in an image because the form is formed in the material, in the matter. Moreover, by passing from one material to another, the form is metamorphosed. It must also be said that clustering and searching through artworks' reproduction independently of their medium effectively solves a difficult problem of cross-domain image search. So the way promoted by Google Art Projects that is not sensible to medium problems, to technique, characteristics allows a cross-domain image search. It's not the case if we already class images through metadata and distinguish, for instance, drawing from painting, from photography. The best solution would be to be able to do a search in two different ways, the one including the relevance of the medium, the other supporting a cross-domain quest. Let's go back to Fossion's book. The description of techniques is very detailed in Fossion's book, and it's not limited to general categories such as oil painting, photography, drawing. In fact, these categories already operate in the information organization procedure that uses standard metadata. Fossion takes a further step and considers the technique as the result of the dynamics created between the type of tool, the movement of the hand, because he considers mostly drawing and oil painting, but gravure as well, gravure in English. So the type of tool, the movement of the hand, and the characteristic of the medium, of the support. Indeed, the materials have a certain purpose, even a certain, I quote Fossion, formal vocation, just as the form has a certain material vocation. The dual vocation is integrated into the movement of production. On this subject, Fossion states, I quote him, matter imposes its form on form. I wish to point out that semioticians have recently devoted a great deal of attention to the question of the media of artworks and the inscription on these media. Take, for example, the work of Jacques Fontani about superformel, supermateriel. The work of Jean-François Bordron on the morphology of the substance, as well as the work of Pierluigi Basso and me in the field of photography. It's the book about which Leah was speaking some minutes ago. And the book she showed you, that I wrote with Jacques Fontani with regard to the techniques of scientific imaging. In semiotics, we have studied the relationship between four devices explain the functioning of a medium. So it's no more Fossion, but it's Fontani, Bordron, me, Pierluigi Basso, and so on. So I make a rapid resume. So the first device is the material support that receives the inscription, for instance, the canvas. The second device is a formal mediation, that is to say, the syntagmatic organization and type of surface that are selected as relevant for this material support in order to inscribe it. So the format, the formal organization of the page, for instance, of a page, for instance, in writing, or of the canvas, if we have to, for instance, to paint an icon. The third device is the inscription gesture, the rhythm through which these inscriptions could be deposited and worked on a support. The chromatic component, for instance, which will allow the inscription of lines and traces on a material support, such as the color contribution, and finally, the inscription gesture. The rhythm of the making, of the production action. It is necessary to conceive the shapes represented in an image as the result of forces involved in each of the components just listed. The material support, for example, is necessarily characterized by autonomous forces that identifies its specificity, such as physical qualities of wood, plastic, etc. All materials have various characteristics of strength, elasticity, hardness, resistance, that we can consider as forces, virtual forces, that will confront other forces, in a more or less conflictual or contractual manner. For example, the forces characterizing the gestuality rhythm during the act of inscription of lines on the support. Does this attention to technique represent a utopia in computational analysis because of the difficulty of calculating these constructing forces? In Francesca Rose's interview with three, we can say, art historian, information scientist, that are Johanna Drucker, Anne Helmreich, and Matthew Lincoln, published in French in the Perspective Journal, the answer is yes, yes, it's an utopia to imagine, to use these characteristics, these important characteristics of technique in an image, in machine learning and in pattern recognition, in computer science in general. So they say, yes, it's an utopia. I quote them. The precision required for certain type of description, for example, the way in which the artist manipulated a particular pigment in a particular part of a painting, and the relationship between this technique and the visual effect produced, brings to mind the spectrum of George Louis Borges' scale one map, which is impossible to achieve in a statistical and automatic recognition of images. With regard to the technical studies of art, the answer is different. I already quoted Marco Cardinali and the technical studies of art. So he states always in the paper I quoted some minutes ago, published in 2019 in the journal Visual Resources. This specific connection of Faucillon's formalism to the emerging field of technical studies has not yet been deeply examined. He tries to put into relations the technical studies of art and the digital art history. But Faucillon was well aware of the relationship of formalism with technical studies, since he viewed the technique as having two meanings, and he quotes Faucillon. The word technique has two meanings which complement and overlap each other. Technique as execution or technology, properly speaking, and technique of style or morphology. So, forms depends on technology in a sense. Cardinali and his colleagues at the Biblioteca Herziana in Rome want digital art history to be closer to technical art history. They call for the complexity of each form to be taken into account as if it were always a stratigraphy of forms. Moreover, by quoting Faucillon again and precisely the foreword to a book titled Le Primitif Français, la peinture clunisienne en Bourgogne à l'époque romaine, son histoire et sa technique, by Fernand Mercier, Cardinali affirms the following. The distinct moments in time in the creative process are inscribed under the surface of a painting. We already saw the pentimento stratigraphy. It is no coincidence that art historian Henri Faucillon assumed this very same point of view, and he quotes Faucillon. In a painting, above and beyond what one could call the optic layer, there is a wall infinitesimal depth not accessible to sight, where various artifices are worked out, whose results are immediately perceived by our eyes without our knowing their hidden sources. The technique works in the depths, but it works on the surface, because the work of art is at once a trade secret and something evident which is deliberately calculated. The criticism, a good criticism, has to be at the same time in the real sense of the words, penetrating and superficial. As I said before, Faucillon's work also allows us to reflect on another question that seems to me to be crucial in view of a renewal of image processing, and that is the notion of background, which Faucillon sees as being decidedly dangerous. We already spoke about relation between figure and background. Except in certain styles where figurines stand out as cutouts of something that must actually be defined as a background, he speaks about, for example, Jean Purcell's Illumination. So he says, to study this kind of things, this kind of images, it remains important to distinguish the figures and the background. But except these cases, the notion of background is defined by Faucillon as something that prevents us from conceiving the forms in their mereological complexity. Yeah, mereological has to do with totality and parts, as you know. In his opinion, it is necessary to study what develops the figures, not what isolates them. It is true that the notion of background makes it possible to isolate certain motifs and to recognize them elsewhere in order to discover visual quotations and influences, as, for instance, is done here in the Replica project, in the Swiss project. The search for quotations of motifs and influences is carried out by the Replica project in Switzerland, for example, which aims to identify repetitions of certain patterns in 16th century pictorial art to highlight mutual influences between Italy and Flanders. But at the same time, does this search for motifs prove to be the most useful way to search for artistic survival, what Warburg named Nachleben? Let us remember that what Warburg was looking for in survival were forces, not motifs, namely types of energies condensed in images of the past that would otherwise have polarized in more recent images. The following sentence by George D.D. Huberman says a lot about the question of motifs. Iconography can be organized into motifs, even types, but the pathos formal, on the other hand, defined a field that Warburg thought was strictly trans-iconographic. So the way of motifs is not the good way for Warburg. In Abui Warburg, Atlas Mnemosyne, Pathos Formula calls on collective and individual imagination to find the links between images apart from those based on age, type, size, or origin. Pathos Formula looks for links in emotive gestures in paintings, no matter the period or the provenience of the image. So Abui Warburg, today, he would not use metadata, but only feature extraction. The problem today in front of computer science breakthrough can be described as follows. While Faucillon and Warburg aim to study metamorphosing forms, computational logic works by digitizing or even decomposing the wall into measurable or even minimal characteristics, for instance, the motifs or the figurative objects that are recognizable in an image. This is how I will quote the French scholar Ian Lecan, that is a chief artificial intelligence scientist at Facebook Research Department, and that describe the context of deep learning with these words. First, in array data such as images, local groups of values are often highly correlated, forming distinctive local motifs that are easily detected. Second, the local statistics of images and other signals are invariant to location. So it's easy to decompose, to detect the local motifs that have the same signature, the vector image signature we spoke beforehand. And the second characteristic of the deep learning detection is that the local motifs are indifferent to location, to localization inside an image. In other words, if a motif can appear in one part of the image, it could appear anywhere in the idea of in the functioning of deep learning. Hence, the idea of units at different locations sharing the same weights and detecting the same patterns in different parts of the array. The fact that the motifs are considered to be indifferent to location within a given totality, in the present case, the work of art, implies that the complexity of the art form is not fully taken into account. Moreover, even in the context of digital art history, and more precisely in the replica project you saw beforehand, researchers have used deep learning on artistic images in order to separate, distinguish, and isolate motifs from the anterior composition. What we really need is to describe an anterior artwork, which cannot be reduced exclusively to a structure made by separated parts, but on the contrary, can be characterized precisely as a composition, which is a totality constituted by tension between forces. Admittedly, we can see here in the slide extracted from the article of Lecan that is titled Deep Learning. You can find it on internet. It was published in 2015 on the journal Nature. Lecan and his colleagues, it's a multiple author article, aim at something other than artwork analysis, and that is to name objects in the context of disordered compositions, like this one, for instance, and automatically to produce captions for complex images. So what is important for them is not to understand the complexity of the image, but to be able to produce captions in front of very complex images. You know, for instance, the caption here, a group of people shopping at an outdoor market, and there are many vegetables at the fruit stand, has been produced automatically. So this is one of the possibilities, it's not a stupid possibility, offered by the deep learning. One has to bear in mind that the identification of objects in an image is not the objective of the analysis of artistic images, especially in the project of genealogy of forms. I imagine that you know the article, the very seminal article by Gray Mass, written in 78 and published in 84, The Semiotics of Figurative and Plastic Forms. It's translated in English. You can find it on internet. And already in that time, everyone in semiotics recognized that the recognition of objects was not so interesting to understand images, especially artistic images. These images, the genealogies of forms cannot be achieved by following the segmentation of the lexicon of natural language or the figurative object segmentations, because, as I have already stated in quoting Warburg, the meaning of form is trans-iconographic, so trans-motive. I have pointed out that the logic of segmentation and the indifference to the location of a motive contradicts, that is typical of the deep learning, contradicts what Faucillon asserts about the need to no longer distinguish between figure and background in the analysis of an image. For Warburg, this is the same thing. As Didi Huberman notes about Warburg, in Mnemosyne, the subjective dimension that Panofsky assigned to the context of the image is moved between the images. So only the inscription of a motive of forms in a chain of images transforms them into expressive units. In this sense, the work of the philosopher René Thom, I don't know if here students know René Thom, probably not, because he always he wrote not so many articles on artwork, and he wrote them in French. Probably he's translated, but not probably the articles about artwork. So, in this sense, the work of the philosopher René Thom is very useful, because he considers that the image is not a set of isolatable parts, but a composition that emerges from the tension between conflicting centrifugal and centripetal forces. Is very close to Deleuze in this sense. We need to remember that Thom is a mathematician and has tried to make the different metamorphoses calculable through seven kinds of diagrams, the so-called elementary catastrophes. In his articles on art and aesthetics, I quote one, the one that I know best, Locale Global dans l'œuvre d'art, published in 1983, René Thom states that aesthetics deals with the relationship between local and global. He describes optimal relationships between the perceptual fragments of a painting and its contours. The composition of a totality depends on these relations. In painting, one of the characteristics of beauty identified by Thom is contour effect. Beauty can be brought to light by the contour and frame effect, which makes it possible to identify the center of attentions that organize perception. The frame of a painting makes it possible to identify in its interior centers invested with a certain prominence, a certain relevance. I quote this article by René Thom. The total space of the work ends up being divided into partial fields which radiate out from the center. These centers are a local configuration of details taken as individual. So radiation from the center to the from the center to the contour, to the frame. We can imagine that this fragmentation comes from a kind of inward proliferation of the frame towards the interior part of the image. So the forces are centripetal and centrifugal. So we can imagine that this fragmentation comes from a kind of inward proliferation of the frame towards the interior part of the image. This proliferation is faster when no particular detail attracts the eyes. Tom speaks of radiation, proliferation, tensions between forms, and these contrasting forces makes the totality, the compactness of a painting. We have to say as well that if Tom devotes his reflection to the forces within the image, as Deleuze, for instance, namely the forces that develop within an image between the contour and the center of attention, he also takes into consideration the question of the propagation of the force of an image towards the outside this image. Yeah? And he speaks as well about the aura of an image. So we can read the quotation of René Thom: an art object is a source of an aura of beauty that fills its entire neighborhood according to laws that are very subtle because the propagation is far from being isotropic. I'm going to conclude. To conclude, I would like to return to the objective that I consider essential for the development of the digital art history. This development should be able to benefit from the knowledge and experience in visual semiotics. Even though an effort has already been made in image processing to move from categorical descriptions, the so-called standard metadata that depend on verbal language segmentation, to feature extraction, it would be necessary to take a step further and adapt the convolutional neural networks characterizing deep learning to the search for low-level features, what they call low-level features, namely syntax, or even syntagmatic links within an image, what Deleuze in his book on Francis Bacon calls the forces and the movement of constipation and dissipation. In other words, attention should no longer be focused on the figurative dimension, but on the plastic dimension of images. Plastic not being a question exclusively of categorical terms in opposition, as we saw in Gramscian semi-symbolism, as intended in a perfectly structural spirit, as Gramsci and Floch advocated in the 80s, but above all of mereology and tensions between centrifugal and centripetal forces, as Gilles Deleuze, René Thom, and the semiotic of tension teach us respectively. Thank you so much for your patience.
Thank you very much. That was a really interesting and rich talk.
What time is it? 5? Okay. I saw it there.
Yes. It's 5:23.
Very good.
So I'm sure the students have many things to ask, many comments, and they can phrase them in any language they like. I mean, in Greek.
In French, in Italian.
Yes, French, Italian, it's fine, even Portuguese, I think.
Yes.
Can we define interval?
Yes, the interval, we cannot define interval without the idea of tension, because the interval is something that is understandable thanks to a tension between we can say symbol, how Warburg called them, motifs in an image that are painted in one monument in history, and that can stay, keep latent for a period, since they are retaken, reused for another painter, for another, and changed, transformed, because he says we can reuse the same form in reversing its meaning, because when a form has been transformed, has been retaken, can evidently change its meaning. So the interval is important, and he says something very, very interesting. He says the distance in time between the first appearance of a form and the second, third, fourth appearance of the same form is already an interpretation, because if it appears 1 year later, it's already, it means already something, that it was a form that was successful immediately in that period of time. But if we have to wait for 10 years, one century, I don't know, for that form to reappear in another image, in another picture, it's already significant, it's already meaningful, because it can be the fact that it was a form that was completely, completely strange for that period, so that the contemporary could not assume it, and time had to pass before this form could be interesting again, retransformed, metamorphosed again by someone else. Thank you.
Like an expanded, perhaps, description of the interval.
Yes.
On the one hand, there's this idea of the interval as something that mediates the two uses of the image historically, so the historical interval. Mm. In narratology, the interval is what makes something a narrative unit and differentiates it from the next one. So it is a narrative device. It's the space in between. For example, in comics, it's the space between two images that creates the narrative contour of each unit of action. Okay, so it's a narrative device. In neuroscience, it is just a cognitive function. We talked about engrams last Thursday, right? What makes an engram a unit of memory, of biological memory, even if this is a very abstract thing to do, and we can never fully isolate an engram, it doesn't exist, we only do that so that we can communicate with each other. But what makes an engram and differentiates it from another one is the interval. So it's all these different things. It's the historical mediation between the uses of the same, I mean, the migration
mm-hmm.
of
mm-hmm.
a motive
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
image.
Mm-hmm. And this form remains latent, in a because it doesn't disappear, in the sense of it can be reused. So even if this form is not the fact that we have to wait, in a sense, this weight can be meaningful. This lack of reuse can be very meaningful, because it shows that.
Έτσι, είναι ανάμεσα σε δύο εικόνες, αλλά μπορεί να είναι και ένα χρονικό, είναι το ενδιάμεσο.
Είναι αυτό που απομονώνει μια σημασία, μια αφηγηματική μονάδα ή και ένα έγγραμμα. Όχι, είναι αυτό ανάμεσα στις, αλλά είναι και αυτό από μόνο του ένα αφηγηματικό εργαλείο.
Περίοδος δηλαδή, ανάμεσα.
Βέβαια, το όριο, όπως μας είχε πει πέρσι ο Τίτρεμ, μπορεί να είναι κάτι διάμεσο, αλλά μπορεί να μην μπορεί να ξεχωρίσει από το προηγούμενο και το επόμενο. Δεν είναι πάντα ένα πράγμα το όριο, έτσι. Οπότε, this is the interesting thing. We're talking about the really interesting discussion we had last year, very useful for what we're talking about now, with a colleague from Tartu, Tidrem, on the notion of the boundary. The interval has exactly the same problem. It is not exactly an object.
No.
You cannot isolate the interval, because it has characteristics of the first use and the second use.
Yes.
So it's
so hypertension is a protension and retention.
Yeah, exactly.
It has to do with this.
Transferring the energy from before to after.
Yes.
But it's this in between that can never be fully isolated.
So only it can be explained in semiotics, can only be explained by the tensive model by Silberberg and Fontani, who use protension and retention to explain a lot of things, but could be interesting to use for this idea of production, latent weight, and then when a second manifestation of the same form is finally there, it's always a retention of something that has been. So,
thank you very much for your lecture. It was very interesting. Could we elaborate a little bit on the concept of aura? I suppose it's
of
aura.
Aura. Ah, yes.
It's maybe the most vague concept of what you have discussed.
Yes, sure.
And isn't it a little bit idealistic?
Idealistic, I don't know, but aura is really something that is very interesting in the use of aura in Faucillon's, but he speaks about aura one or two times. He's not one of the principal concepts. I found the aura as well in a mathematician work, the work of René Thom. I would never imagine that René Thom could speak about the aura of the aura of a painting, the aura of beauty. So it has to be vague. It has to be vague because it has to do with the proliferation of forces beginning from a center that is the painting, and that will grow outside to produce influences on other future images. So it has to be vague because aura is something that will develop probably something beginning from this first image, we can say. So it has to be vague. The same. We go through the interval and once une fois de plus, one time more, because when a painting is exhibited, manifested to the public, implemented in a public situation, we cannot know what will be the impact. So the aura is something that has to be determined through the years, through the centuries, through the tradition that will probably begin
after this implementation of the painting. So it has to be vague. Even the aura in Benjamin's work is vague, probably less than in Focion, because we know that the aura in paintings, according to Benjamin, is something that makes the sacred of the painting, the sacred characteristic of the painting, that is always separated from other objects. So the sacred is the separation. What makes a painting sacred is the separation from the profane objects of the world. So it's better explained in Benjamin's work, but we can understand even in Focion that the idea is a spreading, potential spreading of some forms in an image. Thank you. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. So, what would you say would be the contribution of machine learning in the study of visual images? Did we learn something new that was not possible to do before with more traditional tools? Was it simply a matter of speed, a very fast classification of images that would, let's say, need more people and more time in order to do? Or was it actually detrimental to the study of images in the sense that it remained on a more superficial level instead of also taking into account the more penetrating elements?
Thank you. I hope I understood well. Allora, what is the contribution of machine learning? For me, there is, it does exist, a contribution of machine learning in the field of understanding images. I don't want to say in the field of art history, because I'm not a professional art historian, so I don't want to answer for art historians. But when I studied especially the work of Lev Manovich, I understood that the possibility of visualizing the entire collection of a painter, of two painters, three painters, and so on, could make apparent, perceptibly apparent, a lot of characteristics of images that we can lose if we only look at them separately, or separately and relying on different supports. In the sense, we always study images on different supports, because we can have some images in a book, other images we know through photography, images seen in an exhibition or an exhibition in a museum. So we always have to compare images that we extract from different supports. The fact that the fact that everything is on one surface is already a big help. Not only for artworks, but also for other kind of images. For instance, I'm not sure that I will go to find it. For instance, yes, we can have a look to this image. It's the montage, because the benefit of the montage is different from the benefit of the diagrams. But take the example of the montage. Here we have 4,535 magazine covers. And we can already see, without studying them, without knowing them in the isolated parts, that we can, we have to witness that big changes occurred during this from 1923 to 2009 in the design, in the general design of the magazine. We can understand, for instance, that some features here are transformed, metamorphosed in the second period, we can say, design period of the magazine, that the, for instance, white frame subsists in some, we can have a close-up, in some, even if we don't have anymore the white frame, we can find again the white function in several others images in another design period. So, et cetera, et cetera. So, already the montage can help us to have an idea of the totality of the changes here in the case of the magazine, Time magazine. As far as the diagrams are concerned, the benefit, the contribution is different because we have regions of, we can have regions of images that can be contrasted, easily contrasted. And sometimes we have some images that are totally isolated, like this one or these two. There are other cases, very interesting, that show big differences from the other regions. So, it's differences, for instance, here in saturation and in brightness, that are not so evident when you see the images, when you know their history, sure, but you see the images on different supports. Some discoveries have been done, for instance, in a video about the first video I showed here. It's very interesting to, it would be very interesting to have a look. I don't know if now, I think that I'm not connected on internet, but no, because it's difficult to find the address and so on and so on. It depends on you, but I don't think that we'll have time to. Yes, I have a Duroam, but I noticed that it was not in use today. So it depends. It asked me in disconnect, so as well. But. Even in this analysis of Rochko's career, we can observe that there is only one painting that is completely different from the whole production. So, because for us, according to some parameters, for instance, I don't know, the shape of the contours, this experience has never been repeated in Rochko's career. So we can have from the visual diagram benefit, I don't know, some discoveries that are not possible if you study images from deeper. So the force is the force of the visualization in itself, that is analytical in itself.
Maravich's model with his 7,000 vinyl covers, the whole of
yes.
modern Greek discography. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether you met him.
No. Yeah. But I know other people
based
that.
On exactly this kind of visual. And what he says in the end, I think it's very similar to what you're asking, because what he says is semi-symbolicity and using big data for visualizing, especially chromatic qualities,
yes.
doesn't really teach us anything in the end. It just tells us that it's very hard to interpret, that it's very hard to say something definite about the progress of images over history, and that they have their own life, and we have to study it as a phenomenon in itself, and that is actually visual semiotics. Because it's symbolic on the one hand, okay, it has to do with interpretation, with history, but there's another side of them that can only be approached this way, like technically by amassing big loads of information and kind of analyzing them and realizing how relative our knowledge will always be and how elusive and how...
Yes,
how
because,
hard to pin
because
down.
Visuality has to be, as in this book is tested in a Peirce idea of diagram, to be honest. The organization in a diagram or in an image has to do with knowledge. So we always have to, the diagram always makes proposition, theoretical and epistemological proposition. So we only have to be capable of reading another language that is not a verbal language and that is very difficult because nobody has been formed to the reading of images. So it's the same of what I tried to work out in studying negation in images, for instance. I studied a lot of this question about the question is the image only shows something, only is an ostension of forms, or images can as well hide, retract something, and so on. Because the idea is that image has metavisual devices that allows it to speak for itself, by itself, and it is able to even to hide something to our eyes, to our observation, to our knowledge. So. But what you said about semi-symbolism, yes, probably I can add something to your question, because the idea that the regions, the different regions in the diagrams can help us to understand even the content of images, is that here you only have regions depending on plastic features. Yes, it's nothing. There's nothing to do with content. But you can have a look on the gradual differences in of the micro region and wonder if these characteristics in plastic dimension can be related or not to content differences. So this is the interest of studying these regions, these oppositions of regions determined by plastic and expression plane characteristics, to see if on the content plane we can find oppositions that follow the opposition on the plastic, on the expression plane. It's the idea of semi-symbolism, an opposition coupled to another opposition. Here we have to use not opposition of a term in a category, but a region of characteristics, of features, in contrast with another region characterized by other features, and ask ourselves if these different regions are different as well in genre, in the type of enunciation, composition, and so on, on the content level.
Thank you very much for your presence here, and I hope to have you again in Greece,
yes,
another time.
Yes, coming again. This was just the beginning.
Yes. I would like to do something else about semiotics of images, not about Warburg and Focion, but something that is more specific to my long period work. So, thank you.
Thank you.